A very good morning to all the participants, and it's really good to see all your faces, and some of the faces I can see here. And first of all, before I begin, I would like to thank Principal Ma'am and CA Sharma sir. And I was really listening to the complete session, and I was thinking that today in the session I have to talk about introduction to organizational behavior. And ma'am was beautifully explaining about all the challenges that actually is there in the contemporary world. So she was talking about the flexibility dimension, which we will be surely talking about today. Then the beautifully the ma'am, she talked about leadership issue, she talked about group dynamics, and the how the group issues need to be dealt with in the organizational atmosphere. And even CA Sharma sir, when he was quoting Frederick Taylor, and he was talking about how we have moved from the theory of production to human relation theory. So I was really thinking, oh, that they have already briefed you what is OB, so what should I be going about in explaining it to you? So thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, for giving the audience an introduction, a beautiful introduction. Now, in today's session, first of all, I want the session to be very interactive. So, see, OB is nothing without interaction. So, in that case, we will be having a lot of questions, a lot of case studies, and a lot of things to discuss about. So, it will be really good if people can keep posting their answers on the chat box. And whatever questions you get, whatever things that you have in mind, you can just keep posting over the chat box, and then we can have a discussion on it. So before we start, I would like to know from my audience that what are the expectations that you have from this FDB, and what do you know about organizational behavior? Before we start with anything, I would like to know that what are the expectations that you have from this complete FDB? Anybody? Wait a second. You can post your messages.
To get a tailored approach, I mean, how to approach things in an organization. I mean, we all have just been into some places and we just know, okay, how to do this, but we don't know the reason behind it. So if we can get a kind of a reasons for doing what we do at our you know, respective offices, so that would be a very great thing. That is what I'm looking for as a student.
Okay, so you basically want to understand what we are doing and why we are doing it, right? And I can see some of the messages coming over here. So people are saying understanding the right and acceptable behavior, managing teams, how OB has changed with times. Okay, new challenges in changing times, emerging domains of OB and their applications. Okay, so basically everybody here understands that post-pandemic situations have changed so much. As I was listening to, ma'am was also mentioning something about the flexibility issue. So when I was thinking about today's session, a thought came into my mind that let's talk about the contemporary scenario. Let's talk about the things which are happening in today's world, and let's talk about where we are leading to, where we are going to, what is going to be the future of OB. So today, in the introduction session, a little bit of past and moreover a direction of the future is what we are going to discuss in the complete session today. So first of all, let's start with the discussion on what is OB. So I'm going to share my PPT. Just a minute. Is my screen visible to the participants?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So,
ma'am, during your discussion, I would request if you can just highlight the various changing paradigms during this COVID scenario, and whether the basic dimensions of OB has to be shifted from direct interaction to virtual interactions.
Sure. Surely, surely.
How do we go about? Thank
in
you.
Fact, in today's session, this is something which I intend to do. So maybe towards the end, I'll come back to this question, sir, which you have just put in. May I know your name, sir?
I'm Dr. Satbeer.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, so for such a question, because in today's session, this is all we are going to talk about. Actually, we have briefed it what I'm going to talk about. So I have some lot of surprising elements for the participants here. I'll be going about the things one by one. So what you are talking about is how the things are changing post-pandemic world. This is my entire session is going to be. So before I talk about, let me just go about the session, and then I will come back to this question towards the end, sir. I hope it's okay, sir.
Yes, please. Yes. Kindly go.
Okay. So can anybody just read out the quotation which you can see over the PowerPoint?
Yes,
anybody?
I can.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
You can't build an adaptable organization without adaptable people and individuals. Change only when they have to or when they want to, by Gary Hamel.
Thank you. So thank as you can see what it talks about, you cannot create an adaptable organization just in a day. You have to first create people being flexible and adaptable to the changing dynamics. So as you can see towards the last part of the statement, it says that people do not change so easily unless they have to, unless they want to. Now tell me one thing, what has happened in the case of COVID scenario? Is it they have to or is it they want to? Or is it both?
It's both because they have to, and they, some people, they would like to also change as per the times are changing right now.
Okay, right. So can we say that towards the beginning of the COVID scenario, it was a situation of they have to. I'm sure many of the participants are teaching here in different colleges. Now you must have experienced it yourself. Initially, we had no exposure to technology. We had no idea of it. We were so used to with our classroom teaching and we used to enjoy doing that. The moment I used to enter into my class and look at my students and their smile, it used to make my day. And then thinking about that, the students wouldn't be there in the classroom and then I have to see them over the screen. Oh my God, it was such a tough scenario. For a couple of days, I was just figuring it out. How will I go about the complete thing? So there, I did not have a choice. I had to. I was pushed into this scenario that I have to change my way of doing. But then, now, if somebody asked me this question, then what? Scenario is so different now. Now I want to do it. I want to go into a hybrid model. I want my students to not just be restricted to a classroom environment, but also be connected to me beyond the classes. And this has given me a good, a wide scope of teaching, almost a complete world. Now I realize that I cannot just restrict myself only to my classes and the students, but I can actually go out and reach to people in the world, all across the world. So what is happening? I'm moving from the want to they. I'm moving from the situation where I have to go to want to situation. This is OB. This is what we are talking about. It's people management. This is what we have to do. See, OB is about how, what, and why aspects. Can anybody explain or have any idea what I'm talking about? How, what, and why aspects? What do you mean by these three aspects? Anybody? How, what, and why aspects? Anybody?
Yes, ma'am. Can I?
Yeah, yes. Sure.
Actually, this is related to the organization, that how people are working out there, why they are doing so, and what are their expectations. That's it.
Okay. Very rightly said. Like you said, it's about people. As you can see, it's something written over there, interaction between people and organization. And in the very first moment, the moment I started, I told you, I want us to be interactive. Because if you're talking about OB, how can I not deal with people? It's okay, the platform has changed. It's no longer the offline atmosphere. It's no longer the classroom session. But then the look at the variety which is possible. I can show you the presentations, I can have a discussion, I can have so much of possibilities which were not explored earlier. So it's about people management. It's about how people are doing things, what people are doing, and why are they doing what they are doing. This is OB. So it's a very, very, very tough task. Believe me. I think all the principals out there can understand what I'm talking about. Making people do what you want them to do is such a challenging task. It's such so difficult. In fact, all the teachers can understand. Tell me one thing, how many times you face this problem in the classroom session that you want your students to study? And it is so difficult to make them study. Sometimes there are students who are so mischievous in the class. They are doing, so many mischievous activities are happening. And then you have to channelize their energy in such a way that the session is also going on. They learn things and it's a pretty funly atmosphere that they could feel and they could experience. So this is an organization. How we define organization, first of all. Let's talk about the behavior part later. Let's first understand, what do we understand by organization? Because we need to know about basics first. Before we discuss about the future of OB, we should know what we understand by organization. Anybody who can tell what is an organization?
So it's basically a group of people working towards to make one project successful and to make it happen. And the vision and the mission has to be same for those people.
Okay, you said that mission and vision has to be same for that people.
They should be aligned. Or they should be aligned at least towards the goal which they would like to achieve at the end.
Very good. Goal alignment. You are actually talking about a concept which is organizational identification. I'll come to that later. Yes. Sir, I will request all the other participants to please keep your audio on the mute mode. See, these are the challenges we have in the virtual environment. So at a time, if one would speak, it will be easier for us to, connect better. Okay. So I understood you're talking about alignment. You're talking about mission and vision coming together. Okay, very good. Anybody else? What is an organization? Yes, please.
Ma'am, for me, organization means the association of individuality. Means how the individual, associated with the organization.
Very good. Very nice. So you're talking about individuality being associated with the organizational domain. Wow.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, good morning.
Good morning.
Ma'am, organization is a consciously coordinated social unit composed of two or more people that functions on a relatively continuous basis to achieve a common goal or set of goals.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Just a minute. I will also request, since I can see there are so many participants, about 119 participants I can see. And if all of us speak together, it becomes really difficult. So let's have this thing. You can just raise your hand and one by one, I can ask people to speak in. I think it will be an easier way. And only those people who I call out have to unmute themselves. So sir, like you talked about, you gave me a wonderful definition of the organizational behavior. But I will like us to understand it with no technical jargon. I'm not a person of technical jargon. So understanding it is a group of two or more people coming together and then working towards one organizational goal is okay. This is what we read in the textbooks. I want us today to have a discussion beyond textbooks. So let us look into the world and know what is OB. So okay, one by one, Anupma. Yes, Anupma, you want to share something?
Yes, ma'am. I think it is group of people with some systems and speakers along with the resources given to them. They work towards a common goal. So that is what is an organization. They work towards a common vision. So there are people involved, there are systems and procedures, and there are resources, and there is a common vision. So these are four points that I feel would make up an organization.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Anna. Now, first of all, people, I am not asking what is organizational behavior. I'm asking what is an organization. So if you have to explain what is an organization, in simple words, it is simple a collective unit. We all are a collective social unit working towards the achievement of goals. That's it. People, groups, all these are a part of it. But what is an organization? One unit of people, of groups, working together for what? for achievement of a goal. That's it. What Infosys are doing, what any other company that you take up, what Alibaba is doing, what Amazon is doing, they have one goal and they are just trying to achieve it. And how they are trying to achieve it? With the group dynamics, with people who have their individuality, who are working together, they have their collective spirits, and then they have an organizational spirit. So organizational behavior is a transition dealing with individuality, group dynamics, and organizational structures. Can you see what I'm talking about? From individual behavior to group dynamics to organizational structure, from micro to macro, this is what we are talking about. Like ma'am was talking to you about input-output ratio. Resources, somebody used the word resources. Yes. How you optimally utilize resources and you achieve your target. This is organizational behavior. What is an organization? It's just a combination of these things. Now, getting into a little bit of history, as I think, again, I need not get into it. Sir has already briefed you about it. How the concept of organizational behavior came into. Now, it is not a new concept, first of all. It is something which was there from the bygone times. I'm sure everybody has read Mahabharata, or at least you have seen it during COVID. That is all what we all were doing. We were watching Ramayana and Mahabharata. Everybody has seen that, right? Our epics talk about it. It is not something, a new concept which has come in a day. You can see the team spirit. Can you think that Mahabharata war could have been achieved with just one person? I'm not talking about the role of that Krishna played in that entire Mahabharata, but I'm talking about, can it would have been achieved if there was only one person fighting the war? No. And what if there are 10 people, but they all want to have their own fights? They all have their own objectives. Can we achieve the goal, which is having a transformation? That was their entire aim of that war, right? To bring a transformational change, to beat down the evils, the devils in the society, and to make the good win. So anything we talk about, organizational behavior, it's not a new concept. However, from 1900s onwards, we see a change coming up, as sir explained. Initially, Fayol and Taylor, who are known as pioneers of management principles, they gave up simple concepts. How the work should be done, how productivity can be enhanced, we should divide the work, we should have unity of command. They were the simple concepts given by these people. But eventually, in the Hawthorne experiments, Elton Mayo, he gave a transformational ideology. He said that anybody who knows about the Hawthorne experiment, anybody? It's one of the most quoted experiments. Yes, sir, please explain what was the experiment all about.
Yeah, the experiment was conducted by Elton Mayo and his team between the 1927 to 1932. And the experiment was conducted to find out the relationship between the working environment and the productivity. And this experiment included five experiments, which we call it illumination, bank wiring, mass interview, and lots of things.
Okay, sir, just in one line, if I ask you, what was the conclusion of the experiment?
See, the main conclusion of that experiment was to make an interrelation between the working environment and the productivity. Finally, they concluded that the productivity of the person increased if the working environment is good.
Okay. So what they actually did, they put the workers in a room, they changed the light, okay? They, you know, by making them work in the bright light atmosphere, then they dimmed the light and then they made them work. And they realized that there is not much change in the productivity. So they realized it is not the resources only, there is some external factor which is causing some change in their productivity level. And then what they did, they started using a behavioral phenomena. They started giving them some rest breaks. They started changing their working hours, and then they realized and they immediately saw the impact. The productivity of the workers changed immensely. So what basically they realized, you know, there's a factor, see, even in the dim light room, in a dim lit room, this people were working fine. What is the thing? It is not the light. It is the collaboration of the people. Many of the times you must have realized it. The moment you enter into your college premises, you are so happy to see your colleagues. You're so happy to see the entire environment. What is this? So even if the light is not there in the college, I would still teach. And I'm sure I will, at the end of the day, I will still be giving an effective lecture. So it's not the light which is causing a change. It is the mood. It is my emotions. It's the personality. It is the people in front of me, the people with whom I'm working, who are making the changes in how I'm performing. So this was what they saw in the Hawthorne experiments, the Elton Mayo findings. And initially, it was just in 1920s when they were coming out with this concept. And eventually, this concept became a whole human relation theory. A complete big concept. Now, and then human relation theory changed to something called as organizational behavior. Can you see something on the slide? Can you see the slide in front of you, everybody?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, this I have created a very simple story. It's a story of Mr. Yo-Yo. So this is what you can say is a professional life of a person. This is something I think everybody would connect with. So initially on the very first day of your office or your college, you feel so excited. You feel so thrilled. Oh my God, it's my first day. After the month, I'll get my paycheck. I will get to work. I have grown up. My life has changed. My environment is changing. You feel so excited, full of excitement. Now, Mr. Yo-Yo was one such person, so excited, so full of zeal. He goes to office. What happens? His team members, they're not at all cooperative. They just keep blaming him. Oh, you are so young. You don't even know this. You don't even know this. Oh, this is such a simple funda and you can't even know how to explain this. Who has hired you? How have you come into this office place? And then there's so much of backbiting, stabbing and backstabbing and so many things which are happening in the work culture. Mr. Yo is not happy. He was not happy. He was like, I was expecting that these people are senior and they will mentor me. They will share their experience with me. And I will get to learn so many things. That was the perception I have before I joined. But what is happening? Then one fine day, he was working and working. His boss came up and he yelled at him. He said, you know nothing. Why have I hired you? You couldn't simply achieve this small target which was given to you. Now Yo-Yo realizes this work life is pathetic. There's just work, 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 no recognition. My boss doesn't recognize me. I've been given no rewards. My team members are not helping me out. What do you think will happen to the motivation level of Mr. Yo-Yo? He finally decides, I'm going to quit. This is not my domain. I'm not working in this organization. Yes or no? See, what do you think is missing in this organization? What are the problems in this? What do you think is a big issue? Is it the Mr. Yo-Yo's fault that he is leaving the organization?
Empathy is the main key factor which is missing within the colleagues. Yeah.
Very good. Okay. So before that, as we just talk about it, so as you are saying empathy, anything else other than empathy?
Clear guidelines of works, like unrealistic deadlines might also result in less productivity.
Unrealistic deadlines. Okay, very good. Very nice. And empathy. This is what we will talk about in the tomorrow's session when I discuss about servant leadership. Right now, I will like to show you something in these quotes. I hope everybody can see these quotations in front of you. Just give 2 minutes to the slide and tell me, what do you see? And what do you think was missing in that previous slide? Just look at some of the quotations. These quotations are quoted by the real people, the real entrepreneurs, the politicians, the speakers, the motivational speakers. And this is what these quotations are coming out from their experience. Look at what Indra Nooyi is saying. She's saying, just because you are CEO, don't think you have landed. You continually need to increase your learning and the way you are approaching the organization. What she's talking about? She's talking about learning organizational culture. She's talking about, let's create a learning environment. Don't think. See, what we are doing as faculty members, we are learning. We are learning to adapt ourselves to the virtual environment. This is a complete, continuous process. Then what she's talking about, then let's listen to Marissa Mayer. It said that when you need to innovate, you need collaboration. You need collaboration. What do you think Mr. Yo-Yo was doing with his team members? There was no collaboration. There was backstabbing. Everybody was just trying to get ahead. They were trying to win the war, the individual wars. There was no collaboration. A company's culture is the foundation for future innovation. An entrepreneur's job is to build a foundation. Then when people are financially invested, they want a return. People are to be emotionally invested in. Emotional investment we are talking about. Look at what J.C. Penney is saying. Five separate fingers are five independent units. Close them and fist multiply strength. This is organization. Organization cannot be made by one person. It's the people who make the organization. As somebody was explaining, two or more people. So we never say one person will form the organization. Then if a leader doesn't convey passion and intensity, then there will be no passion and intensity. So leadership is what we are talking about. What do you think is missing in this slide? There's no group dynamics. There's no collaboration. There's no leadership. There are two pillars of leadership, carrot and stick approach and rewards. Both have to be used according to a situation. It's a situational variable. But here what you are saying, it's a new employer, fresher coming into the organization. Obviously, what you expect him. It takes time to know things around. And then the boss is coming and telling you know nothing. What will happen to the motivation level, enthusiasm level of such a person? So this is the organizational behavior. This is the concepts we are talking about. Now, once you know the brief intro, what we are dealing into, what we are getting into, let us talk about what we are going to talk about today. Now, the sir must be wondering that I have asked you a simple question. How to deal with the world that we are facing today. And I said, sir, that I'll come back to this in a minute. Just give me some time. Let me build the foundation. So right now we know what is OB. We are dealing with this OB. We are experiencing this OB. This is not a new concept. It has been there. It had been there and it will be there. But the question here is, what is happening in the future? How our future is changing? What is happening in the world out there? Let's understand that. So there are two fundamental things which I'm going to talk about in today's session, which is the changing work culture and changing work psychology. This is what I'm going to talk about. Any questions so far? Anybody wants to ask anything before I start with this domain? Anybody?
No, thank you.
Okay. So let's start now. It's about changing work culture. Okay. On the very first line, you can see something. Developmental and relational culture. I feel very happy to share with my audience here. I have my own paper on this. It's named as DRF, Organizational Culture. Developmental and Relational and Facilitating Organizational Culture. So I got it published with the SAGE. It's a Scopus publication. So this paper is talking about development of a new organizational culture scale. Now, why I'm talking about this paper? What is its relevance here? I realized in the last few years, though there's a lot of work being done in organizational culture, but all the information is outdated. What people are talking about? They are talking about the same principles which have been going on from ages. We are still talking about Hofstede dimensions. We are still talking about Cameron and Quinn model. We are still talking about bureaucratic organizations, structured organizations, market structures, clan cultures. But what is the real world? What is culture today? And you will be very surprised to know what my findings were. I realized in today's world, there are two predominant cultures which are applicable. And that is developmental culture and relational culture. See, this is what organizations are doing day and night, working towards it. What is development? You're focusing on innovation of your employees. You're focusing in creating a culture of change, of flexibility, a flexible work environment. This is developmental culture. You're no longer sitting in your cocoon and saying, oh, I am not going to change. No, the world is changing. You have to go. You have to, as I said in the beginning of the slide. And then relational culture. These are my emotional requirements. Everybody know Abraham Maslow's theory, right? So it is the fundamental requirement of being a human being. I cannot work without the relational theory. If I cannot collaborate, if I cannot share my emotions with somebody, how can I work in an organization? Relational culture plays a very, very important role, a supporting environment. I think Principal Ma'am in her speech in the beginning, she talked about this. You need the support. Any principal who would run the college needs the support of its people. You cannot just run it alone. You need people to help you out for day-to-day activities. You need a team of people. So these two are the cultural dimensions that we're actually dealing with. And this is what every organization is dealing with. Then what else is changing in the world? The concept of independent working and self-management. I'm sure everybody has heard the term gig economy now. Freelancing. Is this no longer a new concept? 5 years down the line, 5 years earlier, in fact, or 4 years earlier, if somebody would have talked about, would you like to start, your freelancing? I must have thought about it. Oh, what are you talking about? It's so risky. Getting into freelancing, who would give me the job? But today, look at the scenario. Look at LinkedIn. Look at Instagram. Look at any social environment. What is happening? Every person is becoming a freelancer. And they're enjoying their freelancing work. I'm not saying it is not free. There's no risk involved in it, or it's very easier to be a freelancer. No, they have their own challenges. But what I'm trying to say is people are enjoying their freedom. They're enjoying their independence in their work. Now, when I talk about freedom, just remind me, after a couple of slides, there's an article which I read in the today's newspaper. So today, before the session was about to begin, I just opened up the newspaper and saw a very interesting article on freedom. So I'll talk about it after a couple of slides. Right now, I don't think it is the topic to discuss here. It deals with the concept which I'll deal about in a couple of minutes. So independent working and self-management is a new concept which is coming up, and organizations are realizing it. Now there is no longer a hierarchy. No longer a bureaucratic culture we are dealing with. No longer a supervisor I need who will look into, how things have to be done, what has to be done. There's no how and what aspects. It's my work. I have to do it. There's self-responsibility, self-accountability. Would you agree with me? I'd like to ask the audience. Then move to the next thing, digital collaborations. I think, again, you people are understanding. You know what? The organizations are saying now, we need to go for structural changes. We need to change our culture. The working environment is no longer what we were working with. We need to digitally collaborate ourselves. Such a big task, Again, I'll talk about this thing more in a couple of upcoming slides. Then an interesting phenomenon which is happening, people. Remote work is becoming equivalent to being in the office. Now, what is this? Few years back, if an employee would go and tell the boss, look, I want to have the work from home, what would happen? Can anybody say? Can anybody tell what would happen if an employee would go and tell the boss, I want to have work from home for a couple of weeks? What will be the reaction of the boss? I'm not talking about in today's scenario. I'm talking about few years back. If you just, go back in time, what do you think would be the reaction? Okay, I can see a couple of people probably raising their hands.
So they will
obviously he will deny.
Probably there is a question on the productivity as well, that how productive will you be sitting at home and working?
Okay, Himali, very good. So you said that they will be suspicious. They will be doubtful about efficiency, about effectiveness. And they will be thinking that you are making excuses to come to office. You are actually taking a leave. Now tell me, in today's scenario, if I tell my boss, look, I can work from home and give you better productivity. What do you think will be the mentality now?
The acceptance will be high.
See, this is what I'm talking about, cultural changes. You're getting it now. You already know what is OB, what is there to teach. So presence versus performance. Earlier, people used to question performance by relating it with the presence in the office. They used to say, unless and until you are present in the office, how can you say you are performing? And today, nobody is questioning the presence. Everybody is saying, it doesn't matter where you are, you just perform. I want the productivity, that's it. And I'm happy with it. See, this is mentality. People are changing, environment is changing, but let me tell you, my dear students, my dear participants and students, what is happening still is not acceptable in many of the companies. And one such article as I was telling you about, which I read in today's newspaper, is something, an example of this only. So it was about Microsoft versus Amazon. So article said what Amazon did, since it has invested a lot of money in the real estate, it, after the pandemic, once the situations were normalizing, I'm not talking about in context to India alone, I'm talking about the outside world also. So what Amazon did, they started asking people to come to the offices now. That they said that now, okay, the situation is normal. Now let's get back to the office environment and let's start coming to office. What do you think happened? People resented. They said, we are not coming. We have got accustomed to this new working environment. I hope people would have read Mongoose Sold His Ferrari by Robin Sharma. There in his book, he quotes something about the fundamental of having 21 days principle. He says that if you want to change any habit, just adopt that for 21 days and after that you are a new person altogether. This is what is happening, and we have been in this post-pandemic situation from last almost 1.5 years. So after working through remote environment for 1.5 years, one fine day you just wake up and say that come to the office. How can we do it? We're accustomed to it. And you won't believe what happened. Amazon had to change its policies. Because now what they are competing with is all other IT companies out there. They realize people are leaving their jobs because of this change in policy. They said, either you accept our flexible working demands or we are leaving and we are working with some other company. This is a real story, and I'm telling you, let me just show you something. Wait a second, I'm not able to minimize here. Just a minute. Just a minute. Can you all see this article? Is this article visible?
Yes.
This is the article I'm talking about. This is the article I'm talking about. The gap between Amazon and Microsoft on work from home. See, I will just read the first paragraph for you people, and then I think you all can read it at your own convenience. When Amazon said in March that most of its 60,000 workers in the Seattle area would return to the office by fall, some employees were infuriated. A few threatened to quit for reasons both substantial and otherwise. See what is happening. Employees are not accepting it. They are saying, how can you even say that we do this kind of a thing? No. So now you cannot question the presence of the employee. This is what I'm talking about. Presence is no longer a material concept. Only performance matters. Now, I want you all to look at these positive and negative aspects. I don't know how this scribbling is coming on my slide. I hope the organizers could look into this, that why I'm getting this scribbling on my slide.
If you request somebody, please stop annotating. Yes. This is because of somebody's annotating, using the annotating option. So if you could just close that, this would stop.
Also, Soumya ma'am, if you could just see the option of clear screen at the top. If you click on view options, you will go to annotate and you will have the option to clear the screen.
Okay, I got it. Thank you so much, brother. Thank you so much. So, see, this is a big challenge that we are facing in today's domain, that I'm talking to you and all of a sudden I see this thing happening. So, you know, challenges of the virtual environment, how to keep the attention span of the audience going on at the same time to, you know, deal with these mysterious things that are happening around. Interesting concept. Again, the challenges of the new world. Anyways, so look at these boxes which in front of you, positive and negative aspects. I think now everybody has experienced the new working environment, so you know what I'm talking about, flexibility. I can decide, even in this article, if you go through this article, you will find Microsoft has come out with this policy of, you know, giving the employees that half a day they can spend at home and half a day they can go to office. This kind of an environment or policy change they have brought in. So they're giving you flexibility, that they're understanding that you be at home if you're convenient and then you can come and work. So you have greater freedom. you have higher productivity, it's more cost effective. How is cost effective? Many of the organizations had taken, I will request somebody to please do not do this scribbling thing on the slide. I can see the pen going here and there. I would request you to please do not do this kind of activities, please. Okay. So then when we talk about the cost effectiveness, there are certain organizations, they were paying huge amount of money on the, you know, on the lease of their buildings. And now what is happening? They don't require those buildings. People are happy working home. Organizations are happy in saving their cost. So a lot of cost saving is happening. I am sure many of you would have heard your colleagues saying that majority of the IT companies and consultancy companies are telling their employees that, okay, please continue working from home. You need not come to the office. Anybody who has such an experience where your relatives or your friends or anybody have told you that we are being told to work from home till September? Yes?
Yeah, in HCL and Wipro, this is happening a lot. In HCL company and Wipro company.
IT sector, okay. Gaurav sir, you were also saying something? Mr. Kumar
TCS, Gaurav? TCS, ma'am. TCS also, I know a few people, they are working from home, remote areas.
Okay, Accenture, TCS, Infosys, even your, consultancy companies, Big Fours. I have a friend and she has not seen the face of the office from last 2 years. And the Big Four is telling her that please don't come to the office. We don't require you in the office. You sit there and work. So see what is happening. Organizations are pretty happy about this new working domain. What are the broader talent pools? Obviously, everybody understands now, like, for example, you people. I'm not restricted to teaching only my classroom students. I can reach out to anybody from anyone across the world. I'm free now. I'm sure everybody must have seen now the LMS is what learning management systems now people have started using. They've started talking about it. They've started coming out with their own courses. They're floating their own courses. So just like Coursera, now Coursera is also facing a lot of competition. So anybody can come out with their own courses. You are not restricted to any domain. What are the negative aspects? Information overload. See, now the problem is I have information, so much of information, just think from the management's perspective. You are sitting at home and the information is just coming to you from multiple sources at one point of time. You know the future is going to be data management. Now the governments are understanding all across the world that future is going to be about big data management, big data analysis. Governments are spending on it, huge, huge amount of money. The IT companies, your Google, your Microsoft, they're working on it. If you read this book, How Google Works, which I read sometime back, they talk about this issue, big data, data analysis, data management. So information overload and this virtual environment has even become a much bigger problem. It's coming from all sources. And I don't have time to reply. At one point, I'm getting so much information and I have to reply instantly. Team coordination difficulties. Right now, somebody was scribbling. What was happening? Team coordination difficulty. Do you think this kind of activities would have been there in the offline domain? It's difficult to manage it virtually. If somebody is just, you know, opening their meeting room and then just not attending the class or the session or maybe a meeting, I can't help it. It's a team coordination issue that you are facing. How you will coordinate people, how you will coordinate these individualities and mold them into group dynamics. Overstretched meetings. Now, this is a very interesting thing which is happening. So, I again had to talk with one of my friends and she told me now she has no hours of working. And initially, it was okay. But now, after 1.5 years, it has become a frustration now. So, people are calling you at 12 at night and telling you to work. Or they're calling you at 5 in the morning. Or they're calling you on Sundays and saying, no, you have to work. So, what? You're working from home. Overstretched meetings, no timings, no time zones. A simple example, earlier when we were in the college, I know that my college will close at this time, at 6, I have to leave. After that, there will be no meeting. But today, if you have a virtual meeting, it will keep on going. Even if it goes on till like 10 at night, you can't help it. There is no office boy going to come and say that, no, I have to close the college now, please leave. So what is happening? No time zone. Now, I ask you a question, my dear audience. Tell me, do we have work-life balance or do we not have work-life balance? People say we have work-life balance in the new environment. But I ask you, what do you think? We have work-life balance or we don't have work-life balance?
Not much kind of thing.
Not much kind of a thing. Okay. Or?
Long working hours. I don't see personally the balanced piece, because though we can spend a lot of time with family and with kids at home, but the long working hours, you know, ad hoc meetings.
In special reference to India, the working hours is very long. As much government also implied the Labour 2020 code regarding the flexible working days. May that open up the area for work-life balance, maybe?
No, ma'am, we don't have any work-life balance. But when it became the new normal, why? Because as we are working from home, we are unable to either concentrate on the family or in the work. In due course, we are getting frustrated by balancing together at the same place. Earlier, at least we would have given some time at the workplace for ourselves and the work. But being at home, we couldn't able to do that 100%, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Lot of governments, state governments have increased the working hours from 8 to 12 hours. The state like Uttar Pradesh, even in manufacturing sector in Karnataka, they have increased the working hours even if they are going to office or working from home to 8 to 12 hours.
Oh, okay. Nice information. Thank you, Swati ma'am, for sharing it. So I will just simply give a very simple example of me or of any other person. Now, Earlier we had a different challenge of work-life balance. Earlier the challenge used to be people who have kids in their family or people who have parents in their family and everything, that you know, you have to coordinate with your office activities and you have to coordinate with your home activities. But now, earlier the restriction used to be that you have to be there in your office for 8 hours and then you have to come home and then you have to handle that domestic things, right? And the commutation was also an issue. But now the challenge is, just imagine, so many children, they're having their classes at home. For a parent, it's so difficult that your children is having activities going on. Then at the same time, your spouse is also working. You are also working. There's no domestic helper. See, it's another challenge which is happening. And then you have to take care of all these things happening around, because we're virtually working. And then in while this thing is going on, while all these activities are going on at your home, somebody just knocks at your door and says that, no, you are at home only, so I thought of just coming and dropping by. What is happening? This is a new work-life balance challenge that we are facing. So about this question, what do you think about work-life balance? I want you to keep it on hold. In the later slides, I intend to take a poll from you people, and then let's see and look at people and see that what answers we get regarding work-life balance. So let's just put it on hold for some time. Let me switch to the other concepts and then we'll talk about this when I take the voting poll. Okay, I hope it's okay to the audience.
Yes.
Okay, great. So I'm not able to, Varda, I'm not able to change my slide.
We can see your desktop screen. We can see the slide.
Yeah, yes, now yes. The slides are changing. Thank you. Okay. So now let's talk about this new challenges. So again, I don't have too much discuss it. So everybody understands we are facing three kinds of ruptures: technology, behavioral, and managerial ruptures. So technology is, now you have to work with different applications. You have to, your internet speed need to be good. Then so many apps have come up. Recently, I was again reading about it. You know, there was a lot of hype eventually, just some time back, about coding. There were advertisements coming about which were saying that the future is going to be all about applications. So the children need to learn coding from now. And after that, there was a lot of controversy on that. Because there were people saying that if the software engineers out there are not getting jobs, how can we expect a small child who's 5 years old to understand coding? And then you are creating the job prospectus for that child. So lot of controversy was going about this thing, and you know now what is happening. So there was a time when Baiju and all these companies that started offering coding courses. Now what things are happening is people are developing apps in such a way that you don't require to learn coding. You can like the high level languages we use in computers, you just need to know normal English. You give the command and the app will design the coding for you on its own. So what is happening? The technology is changing. But the difficult part is in you getting accustomed to that changing technology. You also need to change with the changing technology so that you could be more familiar with it and you could use it to the best of your advantage. Then behavioral rupture, as I told you, we don't have a face-to-face conversation anymore. So since I'm working in the online virtual atmosphere, coordination is a difficult issue. Then when we talk, we just don't talk verbally. We talk non-verbally also. There are a lot of actions you could see me doing when I'm, having a discussion with you. So just think about it. A lot of gestures, non-verbal gestures. The way you are talking it, your personality, are you frowned? Are you happy? Are you, sad? It is all reflected in your personality. Your motivation, your passion, your inspiration, it comes through your body language. I cannot see that all in the virtual domain. All I can see is just what you are talking, the content. It's becoming very monotonous also. So these kind of problems the companies are also facing, especially in their training and management programs. Managerial rupture. As I was telling you, management is facing a big problem of information overload. So much of information is coming up and how to analyze it and give the answer in just in time. That's a managerial rupture. Look at the statement here. Tell me and I forget, teach me and I may remember, involve me and I learn, as said by Benjamin Franklin. Right? This is what is happening. So we are no longer, we are not getting those advantages of that offline domain, that body language, that non-verbal cues. So if you're just telling me and telling me things, I'm sure you will forget it after some time. But if you are involving me, if you are making me do it, I will learn better. So this is how we can say we have one solution to these problems. We should not just have the, monologues. We should try to use the technology in the best possible way that we could promote experiential learning. Then, just a minute. Okay, I will go like this because I think my desktop screen is freezing, so I'm not able to switch the slides if I go for the slideshow. Is it okay to the people if I just show my slide like this?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay. So as you can see that now what I'm going to discuss about certain companies' examples of remote plus working culture. So this is a new working culture which has come up. As I told you, companies are realizing that they can no longer go with their existing structures and their cultural environments. They need to change it. So they are realizing that we need to create employee engagement. Employee engagement is becoming a problematic issue now. Collaboration needs to be promoted. Team activities need to be promoted. Ask me anything kind of a culture is starting now. That means now you don't have any office hours. So if you have any problem, just call me at any time. Whenever you have a problem, just ping me up. The organizational structures are becoming more and more flat. That means, leaders are coming and talking to you on your computer screen. They're having face-to-face interaction together. So a CEO of the company is coming and talking to me and chatting to me today. So there's no hierarchy. The organizational structure is becoming just flat altogether. Let me give you the examples of these companies. Infosys. So what happened is, after the pandemic, Infosys, they wanted to send a message across the company about to the employees that we care about you. We worry about you. And for that, what small actions they did? They hired their own charter flights in order to bring back the stranded employees back to the country. So they have the company, they themselves took the initiative of bringing back all the stranded employees which are located across the world back to the country by paying for the cost of their transportation. At the same time, they announced that we will not be firing anybody. So don't worry. We care for you. What Alibaba did, you know, Alibaba realized that a lot of collaboration issues were happening. A lot of team activities, people were facing this problem. They were facing the monotony, the boredom in their working style, their working environment. So they announced a quilt event. It's Q-U-I-L-T, quilt event. They said, this was an activity which they organized all across the country. They said, let's all come together and let's create a quilt for the office. So what they are doing, they are promoting team collaboration. So I know that my office has to design the quilt by the end of the day. Everybody will be working together and joining hands and then talking and interacting. And this is what they're building, is relational culture. Collaboration through activities in the virtual domain. IBM took a small initiative during the pandemic times again. They started, sending their employees, they started contacting the parents of, the employees who were working. So their colleagues, they started helping out each other by, providing groceries to the parents who, were not able to go out there in the market and fetch it by themselves. They started having storytelling session for their kids. So they were just showing that we have empathy for you, we care for you, and creating a supportive environment in the organization. So these were the new kind of activities, the right examples which we have in front of us, which tells us that how companies can take the advantage of the remote working culture and how they are bringing a change. I hope the audience like these examples. Anything else that anybody would like to add? Something that you have read or you know about it? Anybody? You can raise your hand.
Yeah, hi. This is Dr. Jui Chaudhary from Bangalore.
Okay, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Hi. I heard about one of my relatives. She is working in IBM. They are providing a lot of support from the technology-wise, like make your home like your office. So whatever the technology required for them right now, like the headphone, proper headphones, table, chair, everything they are providing them. Mm-hmm. And that is giving them like a working place like scenario, or it will feel like they are working in the home, but mm-hmm. they are working from office kind of.
Right, ma'am. I'm sure this is something which everybody would have seen it, that even the Big Fours and other companies also did it. They said, we will provide you printer, we'll provide you chair, we'll provide you table, we'll make you feel comfortable at home. Don't worry.
So she got everything, and she become like, now she's working from home, but in office kind of environment.
Absolutely, ma'am. Absolutely. So now, since everybody has experienced this and you have seen it, let me now talk about some interesting things. Can all of you see these newspaper clippings?
Yes, ma'am.
What you can see? Can you see Amazon, Facebook, Apple, Google all shifting to hybrid work environments? I told you about this news article just now about, in today's newspaper itself, I saw it about Amazon and Microsoft. They're working cultures, they're changing working cultures, people resenting against asking them to, come to office. So what is happening? Apple, all these companies, Infosys saying preferring hybrid working model. Now, we are listening to this day and night, hybrid working model. What is hybrid working model? What is it? Anybody who can explain that?
Sure, ma'am. It is the blend of online and offline.
Blend of online and offline. In what ways?
In working mode, because those who can report to the working organization, or maybe a few of them can stay online for getting things done. So that's why it is a hybrid model, because it blends both of the offline and online modes of working.
Okay, absolutely.
This is what I presume.
Absolutely, sir. Rightly said. It's basically this only. So now companies are saying, you know, many of the companies have come out with different policies. Some companies say they have a roster kind of a system. Initially, there were government guidelines also on it. So, you know, again, people were forced to do it. Then they started enjoying it and it became a norm now. Now it is a new norm. So again, earlier government had put this restriction of 50%. Earlier it was, I think, 33%. Then they switched to 50% that the office people, let's work with the 50% staff. So again, companies had no choice. They had to put a roster system that, okay, 50% employees coming today, 50% employees coming the next week. After eventually they put it across as a hybrid model. They said, wow, it's going really nice. Let's go with this in future also. So many companies have now made it a new normal that we can have this hybrid working environment where people have more flexibility. They have more freedom. Freedom of choice in terms of today I'm going to office, tomorrow I'm sitting at home and doing my work. So more autonomy I have, as I'm telling you, more independence I have, more, you know, I do not face this problem of groupthink anymore. I hope all of you can relate with what I'm trying to say, groupthink. When you are there in the working domain, sometimes it happens you have 1,000 thoughts, but you cannot put it across. Maybe it's because of the leadership issues, maybe because your colleagues are putting 1,000 ideas better than you. Out of the fear, you are not able to share it. Now you have greater autonomy, you have greater freedom, you can put across your projects, you can put across your ideas, and you do not have to worry about the groupthink concepts, groupthink conflicts, right? So new hybrid working models has become a norm where people are saying this only, like even I told you, Microsoft changed its policy, half a day you work from home, half a day you work at the office. So depending upon the company to company scenario, some are putting it in the roster form, some are saying 2 days work from home, 2 days work in office. So this is becoming a new concept now, but still, again, every model has its pros and cons. And if you look at new working hybrid models, it has its own challenges. What are the challenges? Team building. I just told you, you know, I'm working all alone. I'm isolated. I'm not working with my team. I am projecting my own ideas. I cannot see the creativity. I cannot see what others are thinking, what perception they have, what is their thinking process. So it's all working in isolation, working in limbo. So this is what is happening. Coordination is missing now. Team activities are no longer there. Imbibing and retaining culture. Oh my God, culture is becoming such a big issue for the companies. They are saying what we know is no longer there. And now we have to start from scratch. We have to change altogether the working environment. New freshers who are coming into the organization, how to do their onboarding. So imbibing and retaining culture is becoming difficult. Technical hiccups, I guess everybody understands the Wi-Fi issue and all. No consistent routine, another problem. Again, from a talk with my friend, I will tell you. So my friend, again, one of the friends who was working at Big Four, she said, what is happening is people's lifestyle have changed completely. So, you know, some of the people have a habit of getting up late in the morning. So if they are getting up 10 or 11 and then they are stretching their work at 12, what is happening to the other team members? They also have to stretch. They also have to do the working according to their team members. So nobody is having any consistent routine anymore. Work can come to you at any time. You can be asked to work at any time. Your team members may be working at any time. So no consistency is happening. Then in group and even in the case of hybrid models, you know, as I'm talking about, today I'm going to office, tomorrow I'm going to be at home. There's no consistency. Many of the people, including me, I would say, we like the concept of going to the workplace. I don't know about others, but if I want to share my own experience, I like the concept of going to the college. The moment I enter into the college gate, I feel that now I'm at my workplace. Now I'm not going to think about home. I'm not going to think about anything. I'm just going to think about my work, my college, my people. So this is no consistency is there. So today I'm working from home. Tomorrow I'm going to the college. I don't know how the routine is not there. In-group and out-group dynamics, what is it? There's a divide, work divide which has happened. One group is which is working in college, one group which is working at home. So two groups are being formed. No coordination in between. In-group and out-group dynamics. How to, you know, coordinate them? How to channelize their conflicts? Such kind of issues are also coming up. And social inhibitions. Yes, people are working isolation. there are other issues like depression and other psychological issues which people are facing. So with any of this, firstly, again, I would like to come back to my audience and ask, anybody has anything to add to whatever I have just briefed you about? Anybody on this hybrid model?
Excuse me, ma'am, I'm audible?
Yes, Renu, ma'am, you are audible.
Thank you so much, Soumya, ma'am. Actually, I was not able to speak up. I don't know why. Whatever you said is truly right, because I am working as an assistant professor in Core College of Engineering Roorkee itself. So it's on hybrid model, it's not at all feasible in teaching, I think so. It's only feasible in technological areas and all. So I think it is not at all applicable, and a hybrid is totally failure for the educational field. I think so.
Okay, very, I would say a different thought of you. Yes, very good. Yes, okay, Renu ma'am. So again, I have a poll on that, so we can see the reaction of other people also. Yes, Sumit sir, you also have to add something.
So ma'am, what we are discussing today is more relevant to private organizations, and what I can say is public organizations, including government organizations, are way behind what is being discussed. So my request and suggestion is, if whatever we are discussing is backed by research, if it can be shared, it will make us life easier and helpful.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Renu ma'am, I have one small question to you. Nowadays we now know that a concept is emerging, and in fact this is not true for our country alone, it is happening all across the world. Big universities like Stanford, Cambridge, Oxford have done that, the concept of, you know, online offline teaching. So even IITs used to be doing that earlier, but now maybe the things are happening at a different level. So what is this? That some percent of teaching online, some percent of teaching offline. So this is also another concept of hybrid model which is happening. So like Renu ma'am and Sumit sir, you were telling me that this hybrid model is not adaptable to education sector and the public sector. And you have this one idea. Anybody who thinks the other way around?
Ma'am, actually I'm also working in a government city college, Hyderabad, ma'am. But we are implementing the hybrid model presently. Means 50% we are teaching through the online, and later we are going for the offline. But we have a lacking behind a lacuna, because as we all know that the presence of teacher will not fulfill the online teaching. That is the only lacuna, but it is working, ma'am.
It's working.
We could able to reach a little. Yes, I cannot say it's 100%, but to extent what can we do, we are doing here, because higher education department has implemented this.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Now, when you were talking to this, when you were answering Rani, ma'am, I just realized something. I realized that when I'm asking you, I'm a perfect example of it, I think, probably right now. I was a person who was used to offline classes. I used to love my classes. I am a chalk and talk person. Yes. I've never taught through PPTs. I'm telling you.
Yes, ma'am.
I like talking to people and interacting with them. Now, it's a cultural shift for me also. But look at the brighter side. Maybe the negative part is I cannot see all of your faces. I cannot, see your face expressions, your engagement, and all these things, the cues which teachers generally get in when they're taking such kind of sessions. But the positive aspects, I am talking to people from Roorkee. I'm talking to people from all across country. No physical barriers are there. No transportation cost is there. With the minimum cost, the maximum efficiency. And I hope everybody is able to understand what I'm talking about.
Yes, ma'am. Sorry for disturbance, ma'am. Yes, sorry for interrupting you. Yes, ma'am, what you said is right, because if it was like offline, I wouldn't have come over through from Hyderabad to Delhi, but which is possible only through the online, which I could able to attend this program. That is the positive side of the online, ma'am.
Thank you, Ran. And one more example I would like to give. You know, in the department, earlier we used to have PhD pre-submissions. So what was the norm? The norm used to be that I had to juggle with my work and my research at the same time. I had to adjust my time in such a way that I had to, I had to quickly move to the department to attend that pre-submission. Now it's not a problem at all. It is happening on phone. So all I need to do is just click the button while I'm working. At the same time, I can attend and, you know, be a part of that pre-submission or any other FDP program. I can just sit here and I can easily manage between the two things. So what I'm saying, Renu ma'am and Sumit sir and Rani ma'am, you are all right. We all have our own opinions. And yes, personally, I also feel the same. In the offline atmosphere, the kind of exposure, the kind of the feelings that you get, it has no match in the virtual world. But let me tell you this also. Virtual world has exposed us to those benefits which we were not aware about earlier. It are giving us economical, social, and, you know, social benefits. We are able to connect with people we couldn't have connected earlier. So both the models have its pros and cons, and that is the reason companies are realizing it and they are adopting the concept of hybrid model. Do you agree, Renu ma'am and Sumit sir now?
Yes ma'am, somehow.
somehow. It's okay. I also agree with you. If given a choice, I will like to go and meet you people in person and take the FDB, definitely. If given a choice, I would like to go.
Actually, ma'am, we are just taking online classes, and some people, some students are answering, and some students are totally dumb out there. So this is totally, you know, a setback for us that we are. If we are in the classes, then we can see all the faces and the reaction of the students. And I think OB is all about the reaction, one-to-one interaction. Then only you can know the behavior of the people. So absolutely, that's why I correlate it with you.
Absolutely, ma'am. I agree with you. And that is what I'm telling you, ma'am. We don't need to have only virtual environment. We don't need to have only offline environment. What we actually need is a hybrid model. You go see your students, you meet them. But at the same time, we realize that we need to have the other situation also. That, see, through the hype, you know, this concept has just come up now. But earlier also, 4-5 years back, I had this habit. I used to connect with my students on the Google groups. So what advantage I used to have is I was connected with my students 24/7. So I used to tell them, read something and share it on the group and let the entire class know it. So this is the model which I'm talking to you now. Now it has become a norm and everybody else is also adapting it, something which I had been doing last couple of years. So what I'm telling you is there's nothing going wrong with online also. But yes, complete online is pathetic. It's a disaster. I understand. Even we have experienced it. But this is what I'm talking about, hybrid, combination of both. Yes, Sumit sir, I'll quickly take your question because before I take your question, let me give a small task to the participants. Everybody, I hope you can see the small case study in front of you. So what this question is just asking you is that there's a company, ABC company. It had an open culture of innovation and creativity. So what they used to do is they used to ask the freshers for the own onboarding program to come to visit the headquarters of the company. And there they used to have face-to-face interaction sessions with the freshers. Now, because of the pandemic, everything has gone to a remote experience. So the question is asking you, what do you think is the new challenges that the company is facing? And what do you think that the strategies can be adopted for a better onboarding experience for these kind of employees? So I'm giving 2 minutes to everybody to think about this question while I think Sumit sir has something to share with us. Yes, Sumit sir, you would like to share something?
So ma'am, my point again is the same, that when we are having the compulsion of COVID and we do not have any other option, so hybrid is not a choice, it is a compulsion. That is what I am saying. So how we are saying that it is a new norm, it is a new normal. Why we are saying this? We have not seen post-COVID times.
Okay, Sumit sir. What I am trying to say is that it has opened a new window for the people. Earlier, you were right. As I told you, we had no choice. We went about the alternatives. But we all agree with this thing, that pandemic is not going to last forever, right? Vaccines have come up and we are hoping, we are looking towards a better future. So the situation will be normal again. Things will be back to normal again. In Europe, in fact, it started before the Delta Plus came up. Many of the restaurants had been opened up. People again started going back to beaches and everything became normal. The things were coming to their normal life. However, what I'm talking about, sir, why it is becoming a new normal is this thing which we learned because of a crisis situation, which we were forced to learn, is now becoming a comfort zone for people. It's becoming a habit of people. And this is, as I was giving you the example, Amazon said that now the situations are normal, come to office. But people were saying we will not come to office. The group dynamics that was so strong, which forced Amazon to change its policy and say, okay, let's switch to hybrid model. So this is what I'm telling you, sir, that this thing, our habit which has been formed, it has been formed for long. And these companies are going to adopt as a business model and will change their organizational structure as it is happening now. So even after the pandemic, the things will be different. We are moving towards a new future. I hope I have answered your query, sir.
Yes, ma'am, but my last feedback is, and it's not a question, academics cannot be consultants, ma'am. So we have to...
100% agreed, sir, 100%. I'm telling you, I'm missing seeing my participants. I'm missing having a, you know, I had this habit of roaming around my class and teaching. I cannot do that. I'm stuck on this chair. And this is a big restriction for me. I can understand, sir, academics is a field which cannot go into complete online mode, but we are using technology to the best of its ability and doing things which we were not able to do earlier, like these FDPs, connecting with people in the broader zone, that kind of a thing. And giving you one more example of hybrid model, even this can happen while things are going on, you know, physically, they can be live telecasted and presented all across to the other parts of the world. This session will be recorded and put on the YouTube. So people who couldn't attend the FDP can also be benefited from it. So what is happening? This is the hybrid model I'm talking about. You are not just being in the physical domain, but also being in the virtual domain at the same time. Agreed, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Quickly now, I want somebody to, you know, just name a few challenges that do you think that the company is facing with these onboarders. Anybody?
Yes, ma'am. This is Swati.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Swati, ma'am.
Yeah. So, what in the case study, it has been shown that they have been, flying to the headquarters to know the company leaders and understand the company culture. But the challenges would, of course, the travel is stopped and because of the social distancing. So basically the challenges would be if this culture was known to the new employee who is going to onboard, then there would be, you know, loss of charm to travel a new place, because they as a fresher, if you see, or as a 4-5 year junior guy, if you see, then they will have, okay, if I'm running this company, I have to get to travel to that XYZ place. So that is there. And of course it is very important if the onboarding is not face to face, to build that trust and faith in the company and the management.
Absolutely.
So that is what I believe, being in a corporate culture for quite some time.
Okay, Swati ma'am, very good. So I think you are sharing your personal experience there.
Yeah. So I've seen people doing this, and in my team as well. And even if you talk about new strategy, which has to be, adopted for onboarding, I've seen people and in the companies, a lot of companies, I'll give you one example, Tech Mahindra. They have created a new platform, onboarding platform completely, which will, give all the access to the new onboarding and what all the information about the organization to the new employees, and maybe few personalized emails from the leadership and continuous connect with the HR leaders. These are the few things which can be taken care during this pandemic situation.
Swati ma'am, from your insights, I caught two words.
Yeah.
One is, you said personal emails of the leaders.
Personalized
emails of the leaders. And yes, the second thing which you said is informing the onboarders about company policy, company structure, company's value system, right?
Yes.
So exactly. See, every problem has an answer. So we have challenges because the experience, if I tell you today that experience United States of America by sitting over here, experience Paris and Vegas by sitting over here, you will not like it. That's a country that there are places which you actually will like to visit and experience.
Exactly.
I think somebody's mic is on. May I request you, sir, to please close it? Thank you.
I just wanted to come in. And my point is, as the lady also was saying, if the onboarding itself is getting affected, how would we proceed with the total employee engagement, which you touched upon in the initial part of your speech?
Because
that is at the very start, if the onboarding is not okay, the onboarding is not correct, onboarding is, let's say, not up to the required level, then the very engagement of employees will be badly affected, adversely affected, and the employees may not be, may not see the same thing which he or she expected to be in this company.
Very rightly said, sir. And I completely agree. That is the big problem. It's just a very first step. The moment you walk into a company, you first need to know what is company for, right? And if the onboarding experience go wrong, you cannot think about employee engagement, definitely. So that is the reason it's becoming a challenge for the company, how to do it. And like Swati ma'am just briefed us, she told the answer. That is what the companies are doing. They are realizing that it has to be a personalized experience. It cannot be just a screen. It has to be an experiential learning kind of a feeling, because you need to imbibe that feeling into your audience. And that feeling can just not be imbibed through a presentation. See, I could have done that today. Just showing you a presentation, my talk is over. But would that be the right thing to do? I'm also at the virtual environment, but I'm still training. I'm still talking about things. We are still discussing. This kind of talk session, this kind of environment need to be adopted when the people are going for onboarding. There are certain limitations, certainly. You can no longer ask them to visit your headquarters. For example, Google is known for its office culture and the way they have put in things. Everything is there, gym facility. Every facility is there in the Google headquarters. I think the video is also available on YouTube. Anybody can check out that video and you will feel like working at Google. So these things, you cannot ask the freshers to come and experience now, but still some things are there which you can make sure that as the things get normal and as if we are switching to hybrid model, when and then they will come to office, they will experience. But some things you need to work on, like remote onboarding experience, one-to-one talk by the leader. The CEO is coming and talking that, no, it does. The hierarchy is no longer there. It's saying, look, freshers, let me tell you my experience of so many years. Let me tell you what the company is all about, what we are doing. What do you think? The employee engagement will not be there. It will be there. The CEO of the company is telling me that I am important. Importance. Making the other person feel important. Making the other person feel that what the others feel for the company is what they need to work on, this onboarding experience, where we are talking about personalization. That personalization has to be done through the use of technology. I hope I have answered that, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Soumya ma'am, I would like to add here, Swati again here. Sir has asked about the employee engagement out here, that's also a big concern during this pandemic. But if you look outside in the market now, because the employee engagement, which is face-to-face and talking and taking surveys and having town halls, are not there, but companies are engaging their employees through the digital engagement platforms. So there are a lot of companies which have come up with such solutions where you can engage your employees online by everybody's shopping online.
Okay.
They are learning online. They are the kids are studying online. So if you give some packages, say, okay, I'll give you a voucher, or I'll give you an access to a discounted portal where you will get a better discount for your daily grocery needs, or you're saving time from commuting to and fro from office, so you can spend that time maybe doing some kind of upskilling and some kind of a certification program. So they are giving that on a discounted price as a platform. Even Accenture, what they have done is they have run a work from home program where they have got a lot of vendors to set up a small office space in their employees' homes. So along with table, chairs, including pen stands or a laptop stands. So these are the things, you know, they are trying to do. The organizations are even trying to get into it in the last 1 year.
Absolutely, Swati ma'am. See, this is what we're talking about, creating a feeling of love, empathy, and care. Making employees know we care for you. We are there for you. This is what companies need to do. That's it. The moment you create the feeling, engagement is already there. I feel engaged towards my college. So why is it that? I'm not going to college these days, but still I'm feeling engaged towards my college. Why? The reason being because of that feeling that the senior management care for me. They have empathy towards me. So this is all you need to create. And I think if the organization does that, they have done the job. The onboarders are set to fly. Okay, I think I also have to consider the time part also. And there's a lot of aspects which I still have to talk about. So I would like to now switch to another concept, which is virtual offices. So again, I was reading this newspaper and I read about this company WeWork. I was like, oh my God, what is this concept? Let me just know about it. So what is WeWork doing? They're creating virtual offices for people. What do you mean by virtual offices? Let's look at this another slide first. So what you can do is, this is a screenshot from the website of WeWork itself. So you just Google WeWork and you will get to know about what the company is doing. So WeWork says that you do not have to go anywhere. They realized the problem of the people is in commutation. They're spending hours on commutation, which is just a wasteful time. Please, please, I request again to put your audio off. Somebody's audio is on. Please put it off. Thank you so much. Okay. So what WeWork realized is, and this came up with the business model, that you come and join us. We will provide you a physical address where you can go and have the benefit of flexible work environment. So you go and do your work over there. We will provide you a physical address, and that address you can receive all your mails and everything. Basically, what WeWork started doing is they provided a flexible work environment to its people. They said, you get registered yourself with us. We will find the workplace for you. You go there and you work. At the same time, they started providing some ancillary benefits also, like accounting advisory, tax advisory, insurance advisory to its members. And it was a good business model to deal with the uncertain environment. Because if you think about companies, especially startups, they don't know they will be successful or not. Today, they are starting with 4 people. Tomorrow, they may like to expand to 40. So how to, you know, deal with this business environment, this requirement? I don't want to, you know, park my funds in the form of a rental payment for an area, which I don't know I will be needing in the future, or I may need a better or a bigger area. So these companies, they're realizing these kind of things, and they're saying, you don't bother. You don't bother about these kind of things. You just do your work. We'll take care of the rest. So what they are doing is, they are saying, you tell us your employees list. We'll find the place from them to work. And this brings me to discuss another interesting concept with you, co-working spaces. What are co-working spaces? So the future is going to be this. I hope everybody has heard about the malls, right? What is happening in the malls? Few years back, we couldn't even think about so many shops at one place. But today, mall is a place where I can go and have some excitement. I have, I can go and watch movie. I can go and shop. I can go to a restaurant. So everything at one place. Co-working spaces are like working malls. What are working malls? The companies are telling that, look, you tell us your requirement. We will find the workplace for you next to your home. Now, before I talk about this thing, let's first understand the concept of co-working spaces. First of all, dear participants, this was something which came into picture before the pandemic. I was following the articles and I realized co-working was there. Just 3-4 years back, the newspapers were flooded with co-working spaces. Why were they talking about co-working spaces? I'm talking before the pandemic situation. Because there was a concept of open culture. companies realized that now the work cannot be the way it was done before. So they said, let's do away with hierarchy. Let us show that we believe in empathy. We believe in open culture. So what they started doing, they said, let's have a co-working environment. So what they started doing, over one floor, multiple companies were working together. So multiple employees were working together. So that was a co-working environment before the pandemic. But after the pandemic, what happened? So earlier it used to give the benefit of saving the rental cost. That now, if you take the one complete floor, it will be very expensive for you. So I do not have to book the one complete floor. Rather, I just have to book certain cubicles for my employees. That's it. So that used to be the concept of co-working spaces. But after the pandemic, the concept changed. Earlier, for some certain time period, the concept was looking like that the concept will lose its momentum. However, it evolved with the time. When I'm saying evolving with the time, what is happening now is during the pandemic, people realized the work-life balance problem. They realized, I want an office routine. I cannot continue working from home like this. I want to go to office. I want to get a feel of going to office. So what they started doing, they started getting themselves registered with the sites like WeWork, GoWork, Innovate, 91 Springboard. And they started telling them that, look, I want to work. You tell me a space where I can do that. So they started putting people from different zones with social distancing, and they started providing them a cubicle. All you need to do is just have your continuous office routine. I will pick my bag, go to the office, which is nearby. I don't have to commute anymore. I just have to go to the next building and do my work and then come back home. So I am able to maintain the work-life balance. I am also able to benefit from the creativity of people. Because now where I'm going, there are not just people from my office. There are people from different companies, from different cultural environments. I can have 100 new ideas coming into my mind. This is what is happening in co-working spaces. So just see, Inspire Co Spaces leasing 20,000 square feet in Ahmedabad. So we listen to this daily that real estate is going down after the pandemic. And look, the companies have again started buying the buildings. Why? Because they know that tomorrow it's going to be a different world. It's okay, we'll have social distancing, no issues. But it will be in a different environment. So let me show you something. So can you see all the advantages that these co-working spaces are providing you? One, yes, it is cost effective. One, yes, flexibility is there. I can build network. I can connect with people from different companies. It's closer to my home, proximity. Then unutilized real estates are being utilized, because earlier during the pandemic, people had vacated the buildings. Now the question was what to do with those buildings. People who have invested in those buildings, now they have another idea coming up. Many of the hotels have done that. If you are reading newspapers, you must have seen that many of the hotels done that when the hotel industry was down. What they started doing, they started leasing out their places to such kind of co-working companies. They said, okay, let your employees come in and experience it. We are good with it. So these things have now started coming up. You require your employees to work in an office setting. So your work from home can coexist. You are working from office and you are working from home. Both are coexisting together. You can suit the scaling requirements of the startup. And yes, it is perfectly suiting the lifestyle requirements of the young professionals. Why? Because we want, a recreational experience. I want to sit across the beach and take my classes. I can do that. I want to have a couple of breaks in between and just go and grab a cup of coffee. I can do that. I'm sitting in a cafe and I'm working. So this is what is happening in the co-working spaces. Anybody who would like to say anything on the co-working spaces?
Ma'am, may I?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Priya Sengupta and I reside in Navi Mumbai. So we have Howrah Infotech Park out here. And as you spoke about startups, so there were some students of mine and they were looking out for an office space. So out here, they are not giving cubicles, but for monthly rent, 6,000, they are giving you three tables, two set of chairs, and a setup out there. So this was very feasible for the students, management students, those who wanted to come up with a startup business. And it worked for them. It literally worked for them, because today when they are not able to, rent and they don't have that kind of funds available, this co-working spaces helps them to, sustain in this particular market. So I think, yes, this concept works for, depending on the situation, you know, of the individual who is starting a business. And when it comes to commuting or renting place in Mumbai, I believe that it's very expensive and it's very difficult. And this becomes, this is a good solution for them.
Very right, Priya ma'am. And, you know, just adding one more visualization to your to the point that you just brought in. Just imagine those same students which you just talked about, they're sitting with their chair and the table, and just next to it, I put across one more team who are working on a completely different project. And I give them another table and chair, okay, with social distancing. But tell me, Priya ma'am, would you think that something new will happen when the two teams from two different projects working together at one workspace?
Ma'am, they had to follow some protocols out there. For example, those who were into telemarketing, like two competitor company were not given space on the same floor. Because, you know, what happens, generally idea is being generated and you have each company, like, for example, these students were from tourism background. So one more set of company with tourism background. So what happens out here is the script and which destination you're pitching. So that can be easily copy pasted. So there are certain protocols that has to be followed when you're, you know, renting spaces like this. So idea generation, yes. But then I don't think there is any kind of interaction between both the parties.
Okay, Priya ma'am. So that is one thing I think we can, you know, hold as a feedback for all these co-working companies. That, you know, I believe, this is my personal thought, that that type of creativity need to be promoted. I agree without the about that protocol thing. It's okay, we can have the protocol. Two IT companies not working together, fine. But what about one IT company and one manufacturing company? One IT company, one service company, one KPO with a BPO. We can have that kind of a setup.
Yes. That might help in networking. That might help in collaboration. That might help in, you know, you know, budget. And that might help in getting in people to work together for known people. Because when you start working in the same office space and you're representing different companies, what happens is you tend to understand the organization culture of the other company. And because you are encountering them in the lift or in the canteen or whatever, whatever. I'm not talking about pandemic. This is something which is happening before pandemic. So, certainly it helps. Even recruitment process becomes easier because there is in-house recruitment happening. So there are many positive outcomes to that.
Right. It reminds me of a movie. I'm forgetting the name of the movie. I'm just forgetting the name of the movie, but what happened in that movie was there was this lady and she was quite poor and she really wanted to do something in life. She wanted to, you know, start with something. So one fine day, she just, you know, was cleaning the bathroom of her house and she realized that the mop that she was using was not effective. So she just came out with one jugaad. A solution. She used that, she twisted that, she used a kind of a fabric and she just, you know, cleaned and she said it was working. And then an idea clicked to her that what is happening right now is a problem of so many out there. And you won't believe what she did. She just created one good mop, a cleaning mop, through which she could clean her house, clean her bathroom. That's it. She went on to a marketing company. She tried selling that mop. Obviously, it was not easier for her to, you know, get the tender. She went from company to company and one fine day she finally gets somebody who is willing to buy her mop. And then she, you know, sold that mop all across the world. Though towards the latter part of the movie, it happened that somebody, you know, stole her idea, as Priya ma'am was telling, and another company, you know, since she couldn't get her mop patented, somebody else chose her designs and then came out and released it in the market. Definitely. But my idea here is to bring the story is that sometimes the best solutions come to you just like that. The best innovations come to you just like that. Just idea generation. So what I'm saying is, if this kind of spaces are opening up, you never know. You may have a problem which has nothing to deal with a marketing company. You are a manufacturing company. You have nothing to deal with the marketing company. But still, you realize, if I make this product, it's not going to sell in the market. Why? Because I just got a briefing from the marketing department. This is what will happen if we look at these working malls, the co-working malls. And this is what's going to be the future. And yes, it will create a very, very tough competing environment. Like Priya ma'am said, like I told you about Amazon right now, people switching on, saying that if you do this, we are not working, we are switching our company. Yes, you can see a company, another company has a better working environment. Why should we stick to you? We'll leave you and we'll join that company. Yes, but that's a challenge for the company then. Employee engagement, attrition, and there comes the humanity. There comes OB. There comes these principles. You create that humanness in the organization. And then you don't have to bother about it. You don't have to worry about it. You just worry about your work. So with this, I have a small activity for the participants here. There's this link here, which I'm going to share with you people on the chat box. It will take you 2 minutes. It's a poll which I'm taking on these concepts about co-working spaces, hybrid models, virtual work environments. And I want to see what is your reaction to it. So I'm just going to quickly paste it here over the chat box. Have you received it? Participants, have you received it?
No, ma'am.
The link?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Vada, can you just help me with that? I will be posting it again. Can you just share it with the participants if it is possible?
Soumya ma'am, the chat is open. If you could select everyone, you will be able to send it to everyone on the chat. Right now, you have sent it to me only because you selected
me. Okay. So I'll just see there. I think I've selected just you. Okay, I will select everyone in the meeting then. Okay, and I will just do that. Okay, I've done that. So I hope everybody would have received the message now.
Right.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, please click on this link. It will take you just 2 minutes. And I will also show you, I might have the link open here. Just a minute. Yeah, so you will get a view like this. Can you see the questions, everybody?
Yes,
this is a form. Yeah, so I'm just asking you to quickly tell me your teacher, your participant profile. And then there are certain questions. I just want you to, you know, just click on it. It's just a 2 minute activity. And just please do it, everybody.
Questions are there, ma'am. I'm done.
You're done, Renu ma'am. Thank you so much. Others, I'm done, just ma'am. Giving you one more minute. Okay. Oh, I've got 35 responses. 38. Okay, great. What is six? Just giving you one more minute.
Actually, ma'am, it's not working in my computer.
Okay, Amit sir. If it's not working, I really don't know. Maybe it's some technical issue.
Mine also,
Amit,
ma'am,
sir.
Not working.
Okay, what I can do is, maybe after the session, I will tell the coordinators, they can share the link with you. And then you can give your response after the day is over. It's fine, no issues. Right now, my objective is just why I'm taking this poll. I just want to see what my audience is thinking. So I hope everybody can see my screen now.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'm getting around, 82% of my audience are teachers. Wow, that's great. And I have about, 7.2% are people from the other domains. Okay, 7% are scholars. Now I can see here, so there was one question which I asked you, which one would you prefer? Interestingly, 74% people are saying they prefer to have hybrid working environment. So it's amazing. 74% people, more than half the majority, it's majority basically, more than half the population is saying that we would like to go for hybrid working. Then about 9% people are saying 10% now, they want to have offline environment, 10% saying virtual environment, and certain portion, about 7% people are saying they want to have co-working spaces. Okay, why so? I'm quite surprised to see the results. I was expecting majority to say that we want to have co-working spaces. But so hybrid working. Okay, we can have a combination of both people, both hybrid and co-working.
I think just want to say, man, I think most of people, we have never worked in a co-working space. So we have our own apprehensions about it, whether it will work, whether it will not work. And in our environment, it's more to do with. Yeah.
Another issue is that most of the people are teachers. And teachers normally need to go to the university or institute or colleges like that. So there is this co-working spaces is very less. Chances of co-working spaces is very less.
I think that is a possibility of innovation then. Something maybe today you also can think about it. I see, you know, we need to think with an open mind. Tomorrow, if I say that you have to bring this concept of co-working spaces to the education domain, how we will do it? Right now, what I can see is that I'm working in a co-working space environment. How? Maybe not physically, but virtually. People coming from different zones and we are interacting with each other. I think it's a co-working space zone for me. So, but yes, you are right. Physically, we have not experienced it. Physically, two colleges working together in like in a normal routine. Team activities, group activities are okay. But in normal routine, you have not worked in that this kind of an environment. So yes, you are right. But maybe it is something which we can ponder about and we can, you know, there's always some food for thought. How this concept can be brought in the education
and
sector.
This concept, I believe, can be possible only if the co-working space is complementary to each other.
Okay.
Then it can be possible. If something is giving somebody and somebody is dependent on somebody. That means education department is dependent on that particular department and that particular department is dependent on that management department. Then it may possible that co-working space will be developed.
This reminds me of a small activity which our university used to happen some few years back, which was called Andhadhwan. It basically what used to happen in the university was and the Andhadhwani, different colleges all across the university would used to set up a stall at one big ground, which used to be there in the university stadium only. On one big ground, different colleges, like a trade fair. So there used to be competition definitely among all these colleges. So you can say that they were actually competing with each other. But if I just remove the word competition and I change it with collaboration, and I say that there's a project, let's say the project is cultural activity of the university, not the college. And all the colleges have to come together and make it happen. Then say, can we have a temporary co-working environment?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah,
we
can be. It can be temporary co-working space. Definitely.
Just a thought.
Possible. Yes.
Quite possible? Okay. See, this is what happens when you listen to people, when you have ideas running around. Okay, now next part of the question, which one would have a better work-life balance? 70% people say they have, okay, hybrid working has a better work-life balance. Again, 12, okay. Now this is interesting. 13% people are saying that office environment is a good work-life balance. Okay, now anybody who would like to say that, how do you think so that office environment, office environment is a good work-life balance. Okay, in that way, that you are going to your office and you don't have to worry about the home. The feeling that probably I get, that the moment I enter the college gate, I don't have to bother about other things. So that way you say that work is separate, office is separate. The separation is there. And hybrid working, yes, the flexibility part is there. I think that is probably you want to communicate through this poll. So anyways, it's quite interesting to see the observations. And I hope everybody else also like this kind of an activity by seeing how others are reacting to what we are discussing from so long. Yes?
Yes, ma'am. That is nice.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now I had two case studies to discuss, but before I discuss these case studies, let me first discuss the content and then if time permits, I will take up the case study. So let me first discuss the content only. Okay, now another content I would like to talk about blended learning. Now this is something I think everybody could connect with. So again, in one fine article I was reading, you know, education sector is changing, it's transforming. But the question is how it is transforming. We keep hearing this day and night in one or the other FDP or the article. So if you see this diagram, I got to see these facts and figures that it is expected by 2025, our education sector will become as big as $225 billion sector. And only higher education will be of $35 billion. So right now we are just restricted to only university or college. But you know what? So many startups, Baiju is one of them. So many, Khan Academy, I don't know, so many startups. they have got into this education sector. Companies are now taking interest in the education sector. Young people are taking the interest in the education sector. Earlier, it used to be said people who have grown old, the people with the white hair are the one who becomes the professors. So there was this perception, you know, or people who have no hair are probably the professors because they have spent their half of their life, studying and knowing about things, and they spend half of their life teaching them those things. Right? I don't know how many of you know it. This used to be a perception we used to have in our college days that, okay, people, you know, after you start teaching tax, you go bald. I don't know what happens to your hair. You start losing it. So now think about, I'm saying that young people like who are 20 years old, 30 years old, they are saying, no, we want to get into the education sector. It was rare. Earlier, you would say people saying that we want to earn a lot of money, let's get into MNCs. But now people are saying, no, I want to have a startup. I want to go get into the education sector. I want to make a difference. So this is what is happening. Now, 3 M's. What are 3 M's? Method, mode, and model. All these 3 things are changing. I'm no longer using the same method. I told you I'm a chalk and talk person and I'm using a PowerPoint. My method of teaching is changing. My model is changing. I've changed to a hybrid model of teaching. My mood is changing. The way I'm talking to you, the medium is changing. So all these 3 mediums are changing. This is blended learning. And my target is not just 1 student, 2 students, 50 students. We are targeting 39 million students out there. This program, after it is telecasted or after it is put on YouTube, I'm not talking a few category of people. I'm talking millions of people out there on a daily basis. So one more important thing, which I also want to talk about, is blended learning. The positive part of the blended learning that is happening, it's the industry-academia interface. I remember during the offline time in the college activities, we used to call companies at our premises for the talk. Now, it is a challenging and a time-consuming affair. You need to coordinate with the company people. You need to coordinate with their team. You need to see the availability of the speaker. You need to see the availability of the premises. You need to see your timetable arrangement. You need to coordinate with your students. Then you are calling and giving that time slot to the speaker. Then you have to see the hotel arrangements for the speaker. You have to see the transportation, the flight arrangements for the speaker. You have to see the catering arrangement for the speaker. And after the speaker has delivered the lecture, you have to attend to all the stationery requirements. Can you see what I'm talking about? It was a big management affair. But now, in this time, what is happening? Firstly, I just need 10 minutes of the time slot. What I will do, I can connect with any CEO. I just need to drop a mail. Sir, I'm interested in having you online for a virtual session with my students. All I just need to say, check is the availability. That's it. No flight expenditure, no catering requirement, no hotel expenditure, nothing. The person checks their normal routine schedule. They say, yes, we are available for this 10 minutes from this to this time slot. And I ask the speaker to come and attend the workshop, to take the FDP or take the session. So industry academia interface is now narrowing down through this medium. You understand this, that more, the biggest problem and the limitation of the education sector, which I think and which many of you feel, is lack of practicality. We are living in this theoretical world. We are building theories and quoting theories from bygone ages, but we don't know what is reality. This gap is being bridged through this medium. Now we are seeing the CEOs, chairmen of the companies. We are talking to, you know, this motivational speakers and telling them, go come and share the experience for 10 minutes of your valuable time. That's it. And we are building theories out of it. This is the new academics I'm talking about. Do you agree with me?
Ma'am, can I just come in?
Yeah, sure.
Don't you think the very essence of interaction between the academics and industry is missing by this mode? Though it has a positive side that you are saving on time and many other things. Maybe the resources even. But the very essence of emotions is missing over there.
Yes, sir. That I absolutely agree. But I
which
think...
Which is otherwise very essential for a long-term relationship between the two.
Yes, sir.
Unless
for
you,
that...
Ma'am, can I say something?
Yes, sure.
Ma'am, education is not all about the just sharing the information. Education is always human touch. And human touch is missing into this online platform. when we are coming in the offline, when we are seeing each other, we are seeing the face expression of each and every one. We are understanding them better, whether they are understanding or not. We can understand at that particular moment itself. And that is a human touch. It is all about the growth of the personality. It is the development of the personality. That is creating a human. It is not only the sharing the knowledge and creating the knowledge. That's not only the things. It is all about developing a nation by developing human beings. Now, we are not a machine.
Yes, correct.
We are humans. And in humans, we are talking about the development of the personality, a persona, which will contribute towards the humankind, towards the upliftment of the humankind. So human to human, it's not only the information and only the sharing of the information.
That's absolutely, sir, I 100% agree. And that's the reason I told you very first time that I am a person in favor of hybrid model. I took a poll and I told you, I'm a person in the favor of hybrid model. But let me tell you, sir, the issue here is, if I have to talk to a CEO today, do you think CEOs have time to spare? What I'm telling you is, we can tap the untapped people through this mode. You can continue with your existing model, no issues. You humanity touch, that personal touch, I agree, is there when you meet face to face with the person, when you see the body language of the person. Yes, but what about the people who have no time to spare?
That's you, true, ma'am. To access the resources, to get the top class resources, and availability of theirs is definitely a tough task for the different institutes.
And sir, you can say that, okay, a lot of sessions are available on YouTube. See, if I give you a choice between attending an FDP on YouTube through just an online recorded video or having an FDP like this, the way we are having right now through an interactive session, what is better?
Definitely.
Obviously, you say this is better than that, right? So we always have, we have to have a trade-off. We cannot have everything. You have to see your limitations. So if I know that the speaker has a limitation of time, I have being a college or a university, certain colleges or university may have limitations of resources also. They may not have that much for funds to put in to call that a speaker. Then definitely you can go for blended learning. Who's stopping you for that? But yes, if somebody is, I have good connections and I want to call speakers to my college, nobody is stopping you from doing that. But I'm saying a new horizon is opening up where we have no limitation. This is what the other universities, Oxford, Cambridge, are doing. They are not saying we are going to stop college. We will not have any classes anymore. We are going to, we don't need the space anymore. They are not doing that. Spaces are still there. Colleges are still going to open. The courses will still be offered in both offline and online mode. But yes, the difference is going to be that now the horizon is unlimited for you. If you have time, you can opt for online courses along with your offline courses. Now, as I'm telling you, it's the engagement part is voluntary. It is not forceful now. Earlier, we were in the coercive model where we are picking and pushing students to learn. Now it's a pull model. We don't have to push them. You need to be self-engaged and self-matched. You want to learn, learn. You don't want to learn, you will suffer when you're sitting for interview. So this is the thing which we are working on.
Ma'am, like I'm from the southern part of the India. I've gone to Tamil Nadu. I'm a passionate learner, and I was always longing for learning opportunities. But as a married woman with a child at home doing in his teenage, I was not able to travel across to learn. But this online kind of learning method has opened avenues for me to take up an FDP like this. This itself is a great example for what we're talking now. We have no barriers for age, for location. Everything is broken today. And even during the office hours, we are able to take up a new assignment parallelly and completely self-paced. So this gives me new bounds of joy. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vidya, ma'am. And I'm so happy that I'm really inspired to see the inquisitiveness in. I can understand how much difficulties we have to go through. But then this is called self-learning motivation, which I can see in you. And this is what I'm talking about the future also, that we have done away with that push model. It's not required anymore. Yes, Amit, sir.
Yes, Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
I'm from GIS College of Engineering, Department of Business Administration. So, ma'am, for the past 3 to 4 years, we are practicing a concept called flip learning.
Yeah. Okay.
And on the we the teachers also learned about we had a training session on one topic called blend space. We did our sessions on blend space. Then Khan Academy you were talking about. So yes, we have seen that the students who were at one time the back benchers who didn't get the opportunity to interact with us or who feared or they are means later on we found that yes they also had a great great results through this be it flip learning or the as I was talking about blend space and. Another thing I will also like to add that yes, our teachers' activities also have increased just because of this. Because we had to upload, I think, we have to upload more than 100 videos in the YouTube or in the software, and that is the quote unquote disadvantage of this thing.
Immensely, Aviksha, I can 100% agree with you. Believe me, for this one session of 2 hours, I've spent hours on it. First half hours I just spent thinking about what I should talk about to the teachers who already know the subject. Second time I just I had to spend lot of time in just thinking how to go about the session. So I understand this thing which you are talking about, the flipped learning, Avik sir. So much of pain, efforts, and so much of the creative thinking is required on your part, and putting on so many videos, as you said. See, this is the very thing which I talked about in the presentation also, managerial rupture, which I talked about. Information overload is what we as a student, as a teacher, as a management facing on a daily basis.
Ma'am, I have a question. Means I may be wrong, just I want your suggestion. Ma'am, do you think that this is all ruining the actual existence of education? Actually, the quality which we were teaching in offline mode, we are actually not given in the online mode.
Avik sir, for this I have one example. I'm so sorry, I just wanted to check the schedule also because I think it's 11:30 and you also have your can anybody just tell me from the brochure at what time you have your next session going on so that accordingly I will wrap things.
11:45
ma'am.
Okay, because yes, I don't want the other speaker to wait. Okay, so I'll just take 5 minutes, Avik sir, answering your question. Very relevant point. There is something I would like to tell you from something I read in the book, How Google Works, sometime back. Now, there was a problem which Google also faced. You know, when they had come out with the concept of search engine, everybody knows how vast is the search engine. I write any damn query on the search engine, it will just pop the answer out. But earlier it was not working as efficiently as it works now. There was an algorithm issue. Issue was that it was not giving the relevant answers. It was giving all the information but irrelevant. I think that is what is happening today also, Aviksha, like you are saying. Lot of content is there. Something is valid, something is not valid. Something is relevant, something is irrelevant. Which is creating confusion, which is creating a problem of choice. We had never thought of that this problem will come in the education sector. The same issue came in the retail also. If you open Amazon today, there was a time when it was not a big decision to take which mobile you want to buy, which laptop you want to buy. Today, I think it's a very hectic job. You need to browse about so many models. You need to browse about so many companies. You need to see so many offers and then you need to make a decision. So this thing, you are right. And that is how the competency comes into play. You need to have a balance with your competency. We understand you cannot be the master of all. You cannot be knowing everything. But what you know, you should know to the best of your ability. So this filtering ability is something we need to create in the minds today. We need to teach people not about what is the information. Ab hame theories padhane ki zarurat nahi hai. We don't have to teach them ki wo bhi kya hai. We don't have to teach them ki ye concept kya hai. Everybody knows what is the concept. Ab kya badhane ki zarurat hai? Ki how to find that information. How to see what is important, what is not important. How to connect the already existing information to your analytical skills, to the present day problem. So the situation is changing, Avik sir. That is very right and very relevant point. And to that, I will like to say, this is my, again, personal thought on it. Do not go for, this is the problem I've seen in the college also with the young students. The moment they enter into college, they see the competition around them. And then they want to do everything. They want to be part of this society. They want to be part of that society. They want to be into placements. They want to do this, everything. The same thing we are facing as teachers also. I would say, do not go by the herd. Have your own priorities, have your own requirements, and learning is a slow process. Do not hush it. If you follow this, technology is a boon for you. I hope I have answered your query, Avik, sir.
Yes, ma'am, you have
appropriate. Okay, sure. Now just one last slide I would like to show. So these are some of the companies. These are the companies who have taken assessment onto a complete next level, which is online assessments. So now these companies like Mercer Metal, Meritrack, Pearson, Talent Lens, what they have started doing is you can check them, you can Google them in your free time. They have started taking online assessments. So they are helping you out with the assessment tools because they understand it's a big challenge in the online environment. These are the work psychological issues that people are dealing with. I think you already know about them. So these are again some of the clippings of interesting articles which I found. So now people are saying that we are willing to work from a cafe. So many of the cafes have opened up to these working people. Many of these tourist spots, they are saying you come here and you work. So log on in paradise, exotic destinations are waiting for you. All these new concepts are coming of remote working, of hybrid models. So with this, I think because of lack of time, I had other things to share, but I think I would like to stop here. And yes, Devika ma'am, you have something to share?
Yeah, I have two questions. You know, if post the session, if you could.